Well, good morning, Christ Church. It's so great to see you this morning. And also those online, we are blessed to have you with us. And you know, I'm not one of those people that you could say is technologically savvy. So when I know that we can connect to so many people, I just think God is good. And we are blessed to be able to do this. So, and if it's your first time here, we just want to welcome you. And we are so glad that you gathered with us so that we can lift up praise and worship today through song and prayer and through the word. And so right now I'm going to ask you to stand up and let's give honor and glory to the one who first loved us.
Sing my heart.
My heart is open wide. I will receive your light. You give me faith like a child. In you my heart runs wild.
Take a moment and pray together wherever you are, whether you're here in the room, at home, online. Let's pray. And let's talk to our Father. Lord, we ask that you would take us one step further on that journey today, moving from a head knowledge, things that are just true about you, which we want, God, but we want more than that. And we ask that you would move into our hearts, that you would move in our hearts, that you would move through us to reach a world who needs you. So come and do your work. We open up to you. We're not afraid to look a little foolish as we open up to you, God. And we pray all of it in Christ's name. Everybody said, amen. Go ahead and grab a seat.
Amen. Well, good morning, friends. Welcome to Christ Church. Whether you're joining us here in the room or joining us online, we are thrilled to be worshiping alongside you. My name is Steve Noble. I have the privilege of serving on our staff team here at the church, and I am just glad to be worshiping alongside you on this really, really cold Valentine's Day. And if you just found out that it's Valentine's Day, you're welcome. It is also this Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. Ash Wednesday is the traditional start of the Lenten season, and we would love for you to join us here in Oak Brook or in Butterfield or online for our Ash Wednesday service this coming Wednesday. And we will be giving ashes out in a little bit different, more socially distant, safer way in person. And if you're joining us online, we have little individually packaged bags of ashes that you can take as you leave the service here. If you're here with us or if you're joining us online, you can swing by the church. We'll have a little thing outside the door of either of our campuses. You can grab one and you can do ashes at home with your family for our Ash Wednesday service. And as you know, Ash Wednesday is the historic start of the Lenten season. This 40-day journey where we slowly, as a community, walk towards Easter, taking on new disciplines, new spiritual practices to help prepare our hearts, to guide us to the hope of resurrection that we celebrate together at Easter. So we hope that you will join us as a family through Lent. One way that you can do that is by our weekly Lenten devotionals. Our pastoral team has taken on putting that together. And so if you want to join us for that, there's information on the screen. We would love for your family to participate in Lent with us in that way. Pastor Meyer will also be kicking off next week a new Lenten teaching series called Thicker Than Water, where we look at the covenants of God that we see throughout the Bible. We hope that you join us all throughout this Lenten season. Well, today, we are wrapping up a series that we've called So This Is Love. As we've looked at relationships and how do we do them in the church. And I'm mindful, as we're in a relationship series, I'm mindful that perhaps the most uncomfortable point in a worship service for a lot of couples, a lot of people, is when someone like me gets on stage at this point and says, and now let us continue in worship by giving to God his tithes and our offerings, right? Because now we're talking about money, and money's hard. It's been a hard year. It's been a hard year for a lot of us. This is a hard conversation. As couples, sometimes we struggle to get on the same page, to have the same language. And so this can become this point of tension in the service, a point of tension in our relationships. And as a church, we want to affirm that. This is hard. This is a hard part of life. And so we want to help you on two fronts. First, practically. If you're struggling, if you feel underwater, you don't know what to do, you don't know the way forward, you don't know how to have these conversations with your partner, let us help you. This is a beautiful community of people. There are people in our walls, there are people in our community who can help you financially. They can give you wisdom, they can guide you, help you set up yourself up for the way forward. We have access here to incredible counselors. If you maybe need some counseling, you might need to sit down with your partner and have a conversation and come up with a common language. If that's you, let us help you. I am an expert in none of these areas. I personally can't help you very much, but I would love to guide you to people who can. My email is on the screen. You can take that down, take a picture of it, shoot me a personal email. I will guide you to someone who can maybe help you in conversation. Let us as a church, let the body of Christ help you through the hard, real parts of your life. The second way we want to help you as a church is pastorally. As a church, we need to remind ourselves that everything we have, everything we enjoy in life, every good and perfect gift, every resource, everything that we as a church have and we as individuals have is a gift from our God. That we are invited to be stewards of his creation. We are invited to be stewards of his great gifts, and he gives them to all those to us, and he asks us, he invites us to use those to bring his kingdom into being. And so when we worship through our giving, we're not giving up his money or her money. We're giving God's money back to God for his kingdom purposes. And so friends, I'm going to pray, and then we are going to give to God his tithes and our offerings. And as we do that, know that you're not alone. This is a hard area. You're not alone. Let us help you. And know that God wants to use our small gifts for his huge kingdom purposes. Let's pray together. God, we give our gifts to you. We give ourselves to you, our resources, the things that we hold so tightly to, Lord, we lay them at your feet. And we affirm that they are small. We have so little compared to who you are, compared to your bigness, God, but we give our smallness to you, and we trust that you will magnify, you will multiply, and you will take what we give, and you will impact your kingdom. You will bring your kingdom into being. May your kingdom come, Lord, through your church and through the work of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Friends, let's give our gifts to God.
Here I stand before you now, as honestly as I know how. Broken by the days gone by, a spirit helped my soul to rise. Best, but still I fail. And even then, you're with me there. You remind me I'm a child of God, regardless of the things I've done. My hope is found in perfect love. Your mercy triumphs over judgment. Love wider than horizons, stronger than all sin. Lord, is all I want. Well, they say that it's impossible to ever save a sinner's soul, but my God says to the prodigal, my beloved one, you're welcome home. Your mercy, it triumphs over judgment. Love wider than horizons, stronger than all sin. It's all I want.
Amen. Good morning, Christ Church. Good morning to those of you who are here warm in the room, or whether you're warm at home or you're on the road, we're just glad that you're here. We're glad that you are leaning in to the mercy and the kindness of God that we just reflected moments ago. Over the last few days, I have been in Iowa City with my mom, staying at a Homewood Suites hotel while my dad was at the Iowa City Hospital for a procedure. And so we had a lot of time to kill because we were only allowed to visit my dad about 2 hours at a time. So we spent a lot of time in our hotel room. And we decided almost every day that we would just do movie marathons. And so we were scrolling through the TV, looking through different movies that were playing. And I began to notice that almost every movie playing was either a romance movie or a romantic comedy. And I thought, what in the world? And then I realized, oh, it's Valentine's Day weekend. This is the time of year where sometimes couples snuggle up and they lean into a rom-com, or others of you are like, oh, please, no, not one of those movies, nothing that's going to remind me of this day. I tend to be a fan of a good rom-com. I don't know about you, but I think of one of my favorites, one of the very first movies that stand out to me as just a legendary romance movie. It's the movie Say Anything, you know, with the one with John Cusack, where he gets out of his car and he takes a boombox and he holds it up in the air, and the song is just blaring from the boombox in your eyes as he's standing at the base of a window of a young woman, the love of his life, Diana. He was trying to get her attention. When I saw that movie as a teenager, I thought, if any guy shows up at my window with a boombox playing In Your Eyes, he is mine. My husband didn't do that, but he did some other romantic things. Or how about the movie Titanic? I was a freshman in high school when that movie came out. And there's this awesome scene that you probably are all familiar with. We tend to make fun of it nowadays, but then it was really romantic. When Jack and Rose are standing there at the front of the ship, and he's holding her there, and he says, "You want to fly?" And as he's holding her there, she puts her arms out like this. He says, "Now open your eyes." And the wind is blowing through her hair, and she opens, and she is just flying there above water. Or how about the 1997 version of Romeo and Juliet, where they fall in love as two star-crossed lovers for the first time by glancing at one another through a fishbowl. And then, of course, there's always the great Tom Hanks and Meg Ryan movies like Sleepless in Seattle or You've Got Mail. And for me, as a young person, these movies, in many ways, for better or worse, shaped my worldview of what love ought to look like. And there are so many different competing narratives in this world that shapes our worldview and vision of what love, romance, relationships, and marriages ought to look like. I mentioned last week jokingly that I realized this was becoming a problem for me when I finished an episode of The Bachelor, and I said to Jeff, "How come we don't go on dates like that?" I thought, "Oh, come on. Who really goes on a date on a helicopter and lands on a beach and has a picnic there on the beach?" Not very many people. See, for better or worse, whether it's locker room talk, or girlfriends chatting, or Hallmark, these things often shape our worldview of what love and marriage and relationships ought to look like. See, this is our second week of our 2-week series, So This Is Love, where we have been talking about the Christian worldview of marriage. Last week, one of the things that we talked about is why marriages sometimes fail. If you missed last week, I encourage you to tune in. We talked about why marriages sometimes fail, and then we talked about what a redeemed marriage looks like. Today, I want to talk about who it is we take our cues and what it is that ought to shape the Christian worldview of marriage. And we're going to do this by looking at Ephesians chapter 5. If you have your Bibles and you do want to open them up, the book of Ephesians is a letter written by a guy by the name of Paul. We sometimes call him the Apostle Paul. Ephesians is near the back of your Bible. If you flip through, go to Revelation, and then go forward a little bit, and eventually you'll run into it. It's a short little book there. Ephesians, if you want to open up, we're going to look at chapter 5, and we're going to look at verses 21 through 33. And Paul tells us what marriage ought to look like and gives us a Christian worldview of what this looks like. I'm going to ask you to buckle up, because within this first couple of verses, some of you are going to get uncomfortable. In fact, as we were doing the sound check leading up to this service, I started reading the passage, and someone joked and said, "This is a problem for the alphas in the room." So just hang tight. This is a beautiful passage of Scripture. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 21 through 33. Submit to one another. There it is, the word submit. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church, his body, for which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery. But I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. This is the word of the Lord, and I am thankful for this today. Now, some of you might be thinking, oh, why did we have to come to church today? Submit. I have done many weddings, and I will tell you today, a lot of young millennial couples who are getting married will sit and will say, okay, we're planning out their service, and they'll say, what passages do you want read in your wedding? And oftentimes they'll say, just not the submission passage. We don't want that one read. You might be thinking, why are you telling us that we ought to take our cues and our worldview of marriage to be shaped by such an old-fashioned or fuddy-duddy way of thinking about marriage? Just hang with me. Because even for this female pastor, I find this passage to be a beautiful vision for relationships in the church. And so we have to understand that this passage of Scripture is couched within a bigger story, couched within the story of God. So for us to unpack this passage, we need to back up a little bit like we did last week, and we're going to revisit a couple of passages to frame what Paul is trying to say here. As we talked about last week, in the beginning, we see God's ideal. In Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, in the creation account, it says this. Then God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Now look at what this passage says. This is a radical passage to be written in the ancient Near Eastern culture. It says God created them And then it says God created them to rule together over the birds and the sea and the creatures, that together they would rule over the wild animals and all the creatures that move along the ground. It doesn't say God said, Adam, I want you to rule, and Eve, help him out when he needs it. But it says, you're going to rule together. And then we see this fleshed out in greater detail in Genesis chapter 2, this creation account. Genesis 2:18, the Lord God said, it's not good for man to be alone, but I will make a helper suitable for him. As we talked about last week, our understanding of helper is really important, especially as we frame this passage in Ephesians. This word helper is azer. Now, oftentimes we think, oh, this is subordination. God created man and he needed some help. And so there's a hierarchy here. And so we have man and then we have woman. But the problem is if we view it that way and we take this word azer and we see it in other places in Scripture too. In fact, it's used to describe God. In Psalm 10:14, it says that he is a helper to the fatherless. There would be no hierarchy in that regard. So in the beginning, we see this incredible picture of togetherness. We see helper or helpmate, a perfect complement to man. Man and women are perfect complements of one another. We see this continue in Genesis 2:23. It says, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. Again, this is a way of saying this is me, but in another form. This is a perfect complement for me. No subordination here, but they are one. So what goes wrong? Well, as we talked about last week, the fall enters into the scene, and this perfect cohesion that we see between man and woman, this perfect cohesion that we see between humanity and God, we see it begin to decay as sin enters into the scene. Adam and Eve rebel, and as a result, we see the curses enter. And the curses we see in Genesis 3:16. It says, your desire will be towards your husband, and he will rule over you. Again, now this desire could also mean to desire to manipulate or control. And so what God is saying, as a result of the fall, there's going to be this back and forth between man and woman. Men are going to seek to rule over, women are going to fight back, and it's going to be a my way, no my way kind of tug of war. But not once do we see God say, ah, at last, creation is exactly how I want it to be. This is the ideal. Instead, we see the ideal in the creation. And so it's really important for us to understand, before we get to Ephesians, to understand then the difference between description and prescription. Meaning, in this passage, God is describing what life is going to be like between humanity as a result of the fall. God isn't telling them how they ought to live. We see a prescription in the Ten Commandments, for example. A description is describing what life is like because of the fall, because of sin, and because of the brokenness. And we see that all throughout Scripture, don't we? We see crazy things happening in the Bible and we don't know what to do with. God isn't prescribing some of those things, but instead is a description. It is the backdrop of the story of God because of the fall. And so when this curse enters the scene, God is describing what life is going to be like between man and woman. And so we see this back and forth, this lording over. My way, no my way. So what are we then as Christians to do with this? If we know that in the beginning we see God's perfect ideal, and we know now that the curse has entered the scene, what do we do? Well, we look to Jesus. You see, Jesus, because of his life, his teachings, his faithfulness all the way to the cross, his death, his resurrection, and his ascension, he pulls in a new kingdom reality, and guess what happens? the curse is broken at the cross. All of the curses that enter at the scene of the fall are broken and flipped upside down. The power structures are flipped up on its head. And instead, a Christian marriage is marked by the cross instead of the brokenness of the fall. The cross reverses the curses, and Jesus then begins to propel us to a new kind of way. Not a way of my way, no, my way, no, my way. But instead, we see him teach this way, live this way, all the way to the cross. In John chapter 13, he stoops down low and he begins to wash the disciples' feet. He says, "Do you understand what I have done for you? Now that I, your Lord, your teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set an example for you, that you should do as I have done for you." Jesus shows us an alternative, countercultural way from the curse. He reverses the curse in his life. He reverses the curse in his death. He reverses his curse in his resurrection. He reverses his curse in the ascension, and he calls us to a new kind of way, not powering over, as my friend Greg Boyd often says. He talks about this idea of powering over or powering under, but instead, it's a powering under instead of a powering over, where we come alongside. It's a way of empathy. It's a way of serving. It's the way of washing one another's feet. It's the way of love. It's not the way of powering over or lording over. So by the time then we get to Ephesians chapter 5, the Apostle Paul writes this letter to the church in Ephesus and is painting a kingdom vision of how the people of God are to live on earth as it is in heaven, of how the people of God are to live where this curse is broken at the cross, that the people live in the world in such a way that they aren't living into the curse, but they are living into the ideals of God. And what does he say? In verse 1, he says, do it as God does it. Live in the ways of God. He says this, follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. See, Christian marriages and relationships, we take our cues from Jesus, and Jesus shapes our worldview. And this is an important passage for us as we scroll down all the way to verse 21 and verse 22. Paul is giving us a vision of how we are to imitate God in our relationships, in our families, in our churches, and in our marriages. And so then we get to verse 21, and he says this, submit to one another. I don't know about you, but oftentimes in my early years when I would hear this passage about Christian marriages, we skipped over verse 21 and we went right to 22. Wives, submit to your husbands. But right before this, it says submit to one another. Why? Because we are imitators of God. Why? Because as imitators of God, we look to the way of Jesus, who sacrificed his life, laid his life down, emptied himself, power under, washed the feet of his disciples, and propelled us away from the curse and to the way of love. So as he says, wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. And then he goes on, he says, for the husband is the head of the church. Okay. I'm sorry, it says, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church. So after he says, submit to your husbands, he gives us a descriptive reality. Okay? Now this is debated, but many scholars believe that what Paul is doing here is describing the structures of the household as they were in that day. There were structures. If we go to Colossians, we see this squirmy thing that we often don't know what to do with called slavery in the household. It is a descriptive, not prescriptive, but it is a descriptive reality of the structures within the home. And so many believe that as Paul is talking about wives submitting to their husbands, and then he says that husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, he is describing the structures of the day. But then he pushes Christian couples away from the curse and to a new narrative, as he then says, now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives must submit to their husbands. And he paints this glorious picture of how Christ gave himself up for the church. In other words, he's saying, okay, husbands, you're the head of the house. What are you going to do with this privilege? Are you going to use it to power over, as Greg Boyd often says? Or are you going to use it to come alongside, to wash the feet, to say you first, to say how can I empower you? How can I serve you? How can I love you? You see, a Christian marriage is not marked by one-way ruling over hierarchical submission, but instead, a Christian marriage points us away from the curse and towards the cross and gives us a vision of a two-way mutual submission, as Paul says in 5:21. Christians, submit to one another. See, Jeff and I, we've been married for 15 years, and we often get a lot of questions in our marriage, with me being the pastor. For example, recently someone asked him at work, he said, your wife is a pastor. Does that mean you have to confess to her? And when he told me this, I said, yes, you do. We'll do confession anytime you like. But we often get a lot of questions. Well, many people wonder, how does this submission thing work when your wife is the pastor? And Jeff and I, early on in our marriage, we had a lot of conversations. We knew that I was going to be a pastor, that I was going into ministry. In fact, we met while I was in ministry. And so we've had all sorts of conversations, and we have had to live out the rubber meeting the road moments as we figure this out. And sometimes I submit to Jeff, and sometimes he submits to me. Sometimes we submit to one another. Sometimes Jeff makes the decisions. Sometimes I make the decisions. But our focus is on submitting to King Jesus. And sometimes this looks really upside down to the world. Several years ago, when I was a youth pastor in upstate New York, Jeff was an engineer at Lockheed Martin working on the next presidential helicopter. It was his dream job. And I got a call from a church in the Midwest. And we started to pray about it. And it became clear that the Lord was leading us. And Jeff made this radical decision and resigned from his job at Lockheed Martin without a job back in the Midwest. And when he sat there with his manager said, you sure you want to do this? You don't have a job anywhere to go? And he ended up working at Olive Garden for 7 months. That's a wonderful place to work, by the way. That's not a bad thing. But I saw Jesus in my husband in those days. And it's been such a countercultural way in which he often lives. He's in here right now, and he's probably blushing, saying, stop. He's used to it by now. He's heard me preach for 15 years. But even just recently, he was a senior pastor in Southern California, and he was an engineer with NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And my parents became ill, and we felt called back to the Midwest again. And we knew that God was leading us back here, and we made the decision before for sure knowing if he would have a job. We had some days where we were sweating bullets, let me tell you. But we leaned in together. We made this decision together. It wasn't me leading him. It wasn't him leading me, though sometimes that happens. It was us looking to one another and looking to Christ and wrestling through this together in a two-way mutual submission. You see, where is it that you get your cues or your vision from marriage? Is it from the brokenness of the curse and the fall? Or is it in the way of Jesus? See, the brokenness of the curse of the fall is shaped by the world, but the way of Jesus is shaped by Jesus. The brokenness of the fall says, me first. But the way of Jesus says, you first. The brokenness of the fall says, my needs only. But the way of Jesus says, what about your needs too? The brokenness of the fall says, I'm in charge. But the way of Jesus says, Jesus is in charge. The brokenness of the fall says, submit only to the husband. But the way of Jesus says, mutually submit, lay down your lives for one another. The brokenness of the fall says, serve me. But the way of Jesus says, serve you. The brokenness of the fall says, I'm in power. But the way of Jesus says, how can I empower you? The brokenness of the fall says, Lord over. But the way of Jesus says, humility, you first. Do you see the difference? Fight for my way, reconciliation and common ground. What's best for me? What's best for you, for us? An inflated view of myself, as we talked about last week. An honest view of myself before God. An inflated view of my partner. An honest and gracious view of my partner. Driven by eros or sensual love only. Covenant, agape love. Quick to give up, it's too hard. An abiding commitment. What is shaping your worldview for the Christian marriage and Christian relationships today? The brokenness of the fall or the way of Jesus? My dear friend Mandy Smith writes this story in her book, The Vulnerable Pastor, about a man by the name of Joe who climbed 21,000 feet up the Andes, when disaster struck. Just as they were nearing the top, he fell into a deep crevasse, and he found himself stuck into and could not get out as his leg was broken. Eventually, a storm hit and a blizzard came on, and he had to make the really tough decision of what to do next since he couldn't get up, and he cut his rope. And you would think intuition would be to climb yourself back up. But instead, against intuition, he began to lower himself, not knowing what would be beneath him. So he lowered and lowered and lowered. And of course, eventually he made his way to freedom as he was able to tell this story. And he shared, am I lowering myself into freedom or deeper into the pit against all tuition? My friend Mandy Smith reflects on it this way. She says, what if, instead of this futile effort to inch into the pretense of fullness, we made a counterintuitive, countercultural choice? That is, in this case, oftentimes in marriages, especially when things get hard, we try to climb over one another, to control, to seek my way. That's the brokenness of the curse. But the way of Jesus is lower, 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 lower. The brokenness of the curse or the way of Jesus? Let us pray. Lord, I confess that I'm the first to want to climb, to climb over, to control. But I thank you for the renewing presence of the Spirit that cleanses us, that shapes us, that sets us free. God, I pray for any marriage or relationship or couple in here today that is stuck in this match of tug of war, climbing over one another. God, we pray that you would set us free from the curse, and that we would lower ourselves in the sight of the Lord and one another, that we together may be lifted up. We love you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Shame, you carried it all and rose from
hope you received those words. How great is the love of our Savior. The reason why it is so awesome that we take our cues from Jesus is we don't have to write the playbook. We don't have to figure this out on our own. And in fact, those who are in Christ, we find our source of love in Christ. And Christ forms that love in us. So this morning, if you're overwhelmed, I've walked with a lot of couples who walked through the divorce or betrayal or hurt. Hear this. You don't have to walk this alone. Yes, we have Jesus, and look around, we have one another. And there's pastors here that care about you, that care about your relationships, that care about your marriages. And we're here for you and with you. And you don't have to write this playbook. He already did. And so as we send you off with this benediction, we want to remind you one last time about our digital date night this coming Saturday night. You can find out more by going online about our digital date night. We're actually going to have a digital escape room. Well, we're going to put you in rooms, either as if you're single, you can sign up for a single room. And by the way, you won't be alone. We have other singles that have already signed up, or couples, and it's going to be fun and competitive. And we have a study guide that we've created for you, and we've partnered with local restaurants. There's all sorts of wonderful things involved. And what we love about it is it's intentional. Sometimes we just need to make intentional steps to connect with one another. And so we hope that you will check out this date night online, and we hope to see you there. And so now, brothers and sisters in Christ, may I send you off then with this benediction. On this day, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. And the most powerful name of God who created the heavens and the earth, of God the Son who laid down his life, emptied us and broke the curse. And God the Spirit who will propel you to the way of Jesus' love today. And all of God's people, wherever you are, said, amen. We will see you next week.